So now that you guys have gone through all three stages of mixing your dough, and you guys looked inside and saw what it was doing, a couple of you should have heard your dough slapping on the side of the bowl. That's one of the signs that you know that your dough is going through the gluten development, starting to develop that really strong matrix when you hear that slapping. The other way that you know it's ready is when your dough starts to wrap up your hook and it starts to come up the arm. That's another way that you know that the dough is done mixing. So you guys should have seen a little bit of that on your, if you didn't get the slapping, you for sure got the dough up the hook. Now, as you guys can feel, it's real hot in here right now. And if you feel the bottoms of your bowl, it's really warm. That's making your dough start to ferment even as it's mixing. So for fermentation is when your yeast starts to eat the sugars that are available to it and it produces carbon dioxide and alcohol, okay? Those are your two byproducts of fermentation. But warmth also helps to promote fermentation. The warmer it is, the faster your yeast eats, the faster it ferments, and the faster it runs out of food. So it's gonna start to grow. I'm sure you guys have noticed, even just sitting here, it's growing. So that heat that's happening right now from the bake shop, the humidity, and from the mixing is also making your dough really sticky, okay? I watch the weather in the morning, not because I need to know if I take an umbrella. I gave up on umbrellas years ago. They always break. But I watch it for the humidity and the temperature, because those two things are gonna tell me how my dough is going to behave in the bake shop. And whatever the temperature is outside, like increase it by 20 degrees in here. But that's important so that you know what you can manipulate to make your dough do what you need it to do. The most important test that you can do on your dough is called the gluten window test. So I'm just gonna sprinkle a little bit of flour right on top. Just a little bit. Just enough that if not, my hand isn't gonna stick to the dough. You don't wanna put too much on, because then you're adding more flour to your dough than your formula calls for. Okay? So. So my hand has a little bit of flour coated on it, which is good. That is also gonna prevent the dough from sticking to my hand. So I'm gonna reach in where that flour is and pull a section out, okay? And again, if your dough is sticky, just toss it in some flour. You don't want your fingers sticking to it. Again, it's just a light coating. You don't want your fingers sticking to it because you don't want to force your dough to do something that it's not ready to do. You want to let your dough kind of communicate with you without forcing it. So you don't want your hands to stick so that you can really gently start to pull this dough. I keep rotating it. And I'm trying to get a section of the dough where I can pull it to be pretty thin. That's what we call the window. So I want it to be a very, very thin, transparent section of the dough that I can see the light through. So that's number one. And number two, I want it to be strong enough that when I do pull that window, that I can poke it a little bit and it's not gonna break. It's a really, really thin window. And what you can also see when you pull this, you can actually see the two gluten proteins that are linking up. You kind of see like lines running through it. Mm-hmm. Those are your proteins forming a matrix. So you guys will be able to look in your own doughs when you do this, okay? So a nice thin window, that's the best way to tell. So that's called a gluten window test, or a gluten pain test, sometimes they call it. Oh, like pain. Okay, so You guys watched the 12 steps of bread baking yesterday or last week.
Yes.
So you guys just did your first two, which were what?
Scaling and mixing.
So what's next? Bulk fermentation. So what I'm gonna do is get this dough into a nice kind of sturdy dough ball to help keep my yeast happy. So you're gonna use your bowl scraper. It has a rounded edge. And a straight edge as well, okay? So use your rounded edge, and this is flexible so that you can use your hand to bend it to the shape of the bowl. You guys don't have to grab it now. So just scrape your dough out onto your station and try to get everything out so that it ends up in your dough and not in my sink. It's better off in your dough so you can make money off of it and not have to spend money for a plumber because your sink is clogged.
I'm having to spend a plumber on that thing.
They charge a lot of money, man.
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay. Now notice that I did not flour my station yet. So the reason for that is I want the moisture in my dough to have some friction against the wood here. So what I'm gonna do is pull this into a, I mean, I could leave it like this, cover it with plastic wrap, walk away, and it should be fine. But I really wanna make sure that my yeast is totally distributed and that it has food available to it. And we'll touch on that in a little bit. But first I wanna show you the shaping. So I'm gonna use my arms and my hands and cup them around the dough. I'm gonna pull the dough towards me, and I wanna make sure that my hands are staying on the station and that I'm not like going like this, okay? You want your hands to be nice and firm on the station, and you should be feeling tension in your shoulders while you're doing this, all right? Don't be a pansy ass while you're doing this and like think that, no, you need to show your dough who's boss, all right? So, it's nice that that's recorded. All right, so cup your dough and you're gonna pull it towards you. And you'll see that that dough is getting stuck on the back end. I want that. I want that dough to start to get stuck. But now look at the top. See how it's smoothing out? Mm-hmm. You also want that. So you pull towards you, that dough is stuck, but notice that my hands are still here. They're not up here, they're here. This is gonna create your bottom seam. So use your scraper to help you rotate this and keep all that dough that was stuck underneath your hand is gonna stay on the bottom. So you're just rotating it 90 degrees and keep pulling. Yeah, it is. So this is gonna help to distribute some of the warmth in your dough, as well as the food, and give your dough a little bit of strength. Nice, right? And then of course at the end, you gotta give it a little, just a little like a baby's butt, you know? Like, yeah. All right, so now that I have it in a nice shape, I'm going to just slide it over so that I can flour my station. I didn't flour at first because I wanted that friction, right? If you have a really, really sticky dough, like once we start mixing like vegetables and cheese and nuts and stuff into your dough, they're gonna start to get a little bit stickier. At that point, you might wanna put a little flour on your bench. But for these just basic doughs, you don't need to. Now, when you go into the industry, if you flour your station like this, they're gonna make fun of you, okay? You're not sprinkling pixie dust like you're at Disney World, okay? Right, I guess my lecture is a little outdated. Not only are they gonna make fun of you, but you're contributing a lot more flour directly into your dough, and it might start to screw up your formula. So what I want you guys to do is get down eye level with the station, and you'll be able to see that that flour is kind of like in piles,
yeah.
Okay? You don't want to do that. You do that, I promise they're gonna make fun of you. What you want to do instead is throw it. So you're gonna take a nice handful and you're going to sidearm it, okay? Don't do this at home, it makes a mess, okay? But in here, you can practice. Oh, I should probably move the computer. I don't think IT would be very happy with me. No wonder no one can hear me. The microphone doesn't work because there's too much flour in it, though. Okay, so nice handful, and you're gonna now get down eye level. See that beautiful spread? Okay. All right, so now that my station has a nice, even distribution of flour, now I can move my dough onto my floured part, sans the cotton towel, all right? Flour a little bit more on top. And then you're going to get the plastic wrap. You're gonna bring the plastic wrap to you. Okay, this is industrial sized plastic wrap. One of the best things that you'll learn in Bake Shop 1 is how to work with this. That's annoying, sorry. You're gonna do it from the front over, but just for my demo purposes, I'm doing it this way. Okay, so bring the plastic wrap to you, pull a sheet out, hold it tight on the left-hand side and run your finger across it. And that helps to cut the blade. Okay? You are then going to get your marker. Sometimes, of course, it's where I can't reach it. Sometimes it's easier to mark on tape than it is on the plastic wrap. So you're gonna label what the dough is and what time it came off the mixer. We're gonna estimate yours at like 3:10. Okay, so 3:10. The reason for this is, like I mentioned before, usually you guys are making all kinds of different doughs, and being able to troubleshoot is led by knowing what your dough is supposed to look like. So because I've been making these doughs for 8 years, I know how they ferment. So some doughs grow really high up, other doughs grow out, other doughs don't get a ton of bubbles. So I need to know what the dough is so that I can monitor how well it's fermenting so that if something went wrong, we can control it. Sometimes I might move your dough around, like if it's really hot by the oven, but it's like really cool back here, I might put it in a bowl and move it closer to the oven or whatever it is. But I also need to know the time so that I know how long it's been fermenting for. And again, to troubleshoot, okay, this has been sitting there for an hour, we need to move on, or it's gonna over ferment, or you know, stuff like that. So you can label right on the plastic wrap, but you might find masking tape is a little bit more helpful. So right now this is going into bulk fermentation. Usually bulk fermentation does not last more than like an hour and 20 minutes max. Because it's so hot in here right now, it's probably gonna be about 20 minutes. So you guys are gonna watch that your dough is gonna start to basically double in size. It's already been growing. And as it grows, the plastic wrap is gonna move. So if you see that it's been sitting there and there's like a piece of dough that's exposed, just throw another piece of plastic wrap over it. And the plastic wrap is to prevent the dough from drying out. If it's exposed to air, it gets this, it's kind of like when you get dry elbows in the winter. It's like that on the dough. We call it elephant skin. And the reason that that's so bad is that once that gets incorporated into your dough, you can't get rid of it. And then in the oven, that portion of your dough doesn't rise. And then you end up with these weirdly shaped loaves and rolls where it's like it rose on this side, but not on this side, so it exploded out of here. And the idea is to keep everything consistent, because consistency is what keeps your customers loyal. So remember, everything, it's like a domino effect, right? And everything translates to money, right? Okay, so bulk fermentation. And I think that's it. All right, so scaling, mixing, bulk ferment.